There are so many different uses for VBT in your training and programming. Some of them easy, others are a little more complex and time consuming to implement and get great results. In this video, I'm going to cover what I consider to be the five key different ways you can use velocity tracking in the gym to give your training a boost. We'll be unpacking each of these concepts in their own video shortly, but it's important to remember that all these concepts and ideas, they're integrated. So you don't have to pick one and exclude the others. In fact, they work really well if you combine and integrate different ideas from different concepts within the VBT world. Using velocity tracking in the gym to give feedback and provide context to athletes is, I think, the most important and also one of the simplest ways you can use velocity-based training in the gym. There's really good research that this has a proven ability to improve performance in the gym, but also increase transfer to your athletic performance on the court or on the field. It's really simple. All you have to do is take a number and have your athletes compete on it. So instead of just chasing weight on the bar, they're now also chasing velocity. Maybe it's peak power, whatever the number might be. To step this up even further, you can try the idea of contextual data. That means what you do is just compare yourself to your former self. So what we want to do is, say on a bench press, you do 20, 60, and 80 kilos as your first three warm-up sets. From those three sets, we can see how well you've lifted compared to your former self. So you can try and beat that score, maybe beat your 30-day average, or you can use it as an autoregulation and a readiness tool. That's something we'll talk about in a second. Now, I'm not a huge fan of the standard velocity zones idea, but I still think there's plenty of value in using targets and thresholds with your training, either as a simple form of feedback or as a way to motivate your athletes just to get a little more out of themselves. So it could be peak power or load at peak power. We could be trying to target weights and sets around those numbers, or it could just be a velocity target. So your work sets don't count until you reach a certain threshold. These bands and cutoffs, they can be arbitrary and they can be fixed, but the gold standard really is to make them individualized and tailored to an athlete. So based on each exercise, an individual's profile and their performance on that movement, you adjust the goals, the targets, and the thresholds to that person. Tracking performance over time is a really good use of the technology. It allows you to shift the focus from just checking how much weight you can lift on your top sets to other numbers like power, maybe even range of motion or velocity of your lifts, so you can focus on that intent piece as well. What's really good about this is you can track those numbers in real time. You don't have to have dedicated testing days for your collection of data, so you don't interrupt the training flow. You can collect it in real time just during a normal session. Just collect velocity from that warm-up set all the way through their work sets, and you can do calculations with those numbers. So we've kind of touched on autoregulation already. It's a really broad general term, but basically it's about adjusting your training in real time to get the best results. One practical example of this autoregulation is to use a traffic light system in your training. So you take today's velocities compared to your most recent 30 days for that exercise and that load, and you compare. So say, for example, you're above 97% of your 30-day average for that 60 kilo squat, as an example, then good, that's a green light, carry on. No need to make any adjustments. If you're, say, between 92 and 97%, maybe that's an orange light. Maybe you need to ask yourself a question. Maybe I'm fatigued, maybe I need to have a little deload today. If you're below 90% of your 30-day average for velocity on a movement, that's probably time to consider a taper. Maybe today isn't the day to be doing some high explosive power work or heavy strength training. Take your volume back, do less sets, adjust your training to allow your body to recover, because there's no point training harder if you're already in a hole. You need to allow recovery time so you can supercompensate out. The fifth and final application for VBT is less an application and more a combination of the four concepts we've already spoken about. So while we want to be opportunistic in real time in each session, so how the athlete walks in, how they present should dictate how the training looks, we also want to have a plan of where we're going. If they come in fatigued every single session and we keep going backwards, then we're not doing our job as coaches of helping the athlete become better. So we need to ask questions. Are they doing enough recovery work? Are they overloaded on the court or on the field? Making those assessments and having that sort of longer term plan allows us to be better with our flexibility on a day-to-day basis. And one final note before you head off and watch the next video in the series. It's important to note that all these concepts are not siloed. You can integrate them and work them together. You don't have to be a VBT specialist and use it in isolation to get great results. In fact, you'll get better results if you integrate it with other proven and effective methods. That's it. I'll see you in the next video.